It's still in 1 Peter, in the second chapter, and we begin with verse 18. And I'd like you to take out your Bible and read it. And then I'm going to read it to you in the famous Phillips translation. A book, incidentally, you ought to own, but it's for young churches. That's it. Very well heralded and very much loved, and even in the best fundamental circles. Now, from verse 18 to verse 25, inclusive, here's what Peter said in the language. He said, "You who are servants, should submit yourselves to other respect, not only to the good and kind, but also to the difficult. A man does something valuable when he endures it in the sight of God, though he knows he's suffering unjustly. After all, it is no credit to you if you are in a punishment which you have richly deserved. But if you do your duty and are punished for it, and can still accept the patient as something worthwhile in God's sight, indeed, this is part of your calling. For Christ suffered for you and left you a personal example to follow in his steps. He was guilty of no sin or the slightest divergence, yet he offered no insult in return. When he suffered, he made no threat of revenge. He simply submitted his cause to the one, and he personally bore our sins in his own body on the cross, so that he might be dead, we might be dead to sin, for all his good. It was the suffering that he bore that has healed you. You had wandered away like, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of your soul." Now, we have been dealing with the Christian attitude, the attitude toward the government, the attitude toward all created things, toward mankind, particularly toward God. Now, we deal with our attitude toward difficult people. If I were giving my talk a name, I would call it How to Live with Difficult People. Here, in effect, in your particular social system, there are masters. All right. Though you as a Christian, you know that no man is birth and no man is a servant by birth. You as a Christian know that things are all good. And there isn't any such thing as aristocratic blood. All that's an illusion. Nobody has inherited blue blood. That's an illusion. We Christians know that. We know that all men turn before God. We know that the son of a black slave from Africa can become a Booker T. Washington. The son of the aristocrat from Boston can become a murderer. We know that men are men, beforehand, regardless of the social bracket into which they are born. Now, if you say, Peter, in effect, you know that. You are not called, however, to be a revolutionist, neither political nor social. You are not called to institute a revolution and upset the social and political you live. You are called, rather, to adapt yourself to your political and social environment so that your home is in heaven and you're only just here as exiles for a little while. Therefore, you as a Christian are called to enter the field of politics and try to put into practice the ties you entertain as a Christian, but which you know will never be put into effect till the end. You can afford to wait. You're to adapt yourself and obey those over you. Submit yourself unto authority. So long as we do not violate the will of God or cause you to do anything that's wrong. When we do, disobey them and go to jail. But as long as they are not wrong, obey them and live at peace. Now the matter of everybody knows there's nobody born in master by blood. And everyone knows there is no one good. We are what we are, masters of servants, and there will be some in those position and in this who have to serve and others who have to give orders. We do give orders. We call it employer and employee, then they call it master and servant. And I said, Peter, just as your attitude here, your attitude toward kings is to be honest, your attitude toward all men is to be honest. Now your attitude toward your employer, if the master is to be obedient, and you're to be that way, acting like a Christian, not only to those that are easy to live with, but to the poor. And so we deal this morning, briefly, with a Christian's attitude toward the soul. Now the word forward here isn't the word that's used in our time. Nobody uses forward. Have you ever heard of that? Today, unless it is a quotation from Scripture, you raise your eyebrows and say, what's the matter? Well, suppose you've got the celluloid collar on. And we know that we don't drive buggies to the side of the road anymore. Forward belongs way back younger. But what kind of forward person with which you've got to live? Either if he's your employer, or if he's in your home, or if you're forced to her. Now, we must not only learn to live with this forward person, but we must learn even to submit to him. Now, that ugly, harsh word, forward, represents that number, that group of letters don't know what to do with. It is a Greek word that has no English equivalent. So, this is a chance. And way back 350 years ago, 340 years ago, word meant what they meant, what the Greek word meant, but it isn't what it means now. So I put to look up 12 different translations and see how they handle this word forward. The ones will bear those over you. Not only to the good in time, but also to the difficult. That's in the Philip translation. One says, not only to the good in time, but also to the hard to please. Another one says, sir, to bad humor. Another one says, ill temper. Another one says, cross. Another one says unreasonable. Another says, and then my good brave Scott, New Testament says, that you are to submit yourself to the flower, which means. And then we have another translation that says the cruel, another says overbearing, and another says unfair. That's the thing, what a man would look like if he had packed into one personality or all these adjectives. Any man who was unfair, cruel, contrary, arbitrary, unreasonable, bad humor, ill-tempered, cross, fairly hard to please, and difficult, whether he'd be in jail for and if he wasn't in jail, he certainly would be in the cemetery shortly. Somebody would go over. So I don't mean that any one man. Any one of these is enough, but any one. In other words, the word has a bad disposition. And the Holy Ghost says, you servants, be subject to your masters with all, not only to the good and gentle, but also to those of bad disposition. Let me repeat here what I've said many times, that a bad disposition is worse than any of the dramatic so-called great sins that we hear about. We don't, nobody goes to jail position, usually doesn't get killed for it. And there's nothing colorful about it. And you never see a great headline on with terror this morning. It just doesn't get dramatized. And so we picked out a few great sins, a great sin. But when our Lord was on earth, he didn't have his trouble with the murderers, revolutionists. He had his trouble with men of bad disposition, religious people who were difficult, bad-humored, ill-tempered, hard-carried, contrary, overbearing, and unfair. And I would say that a bad disposition causes more good than any other evil in the world. Take that man who drinks. Many a man drinks, and when he's inebriated, which means he's drunk. He may be a bit hard to live with, but all losers, when they come out of that, are kind fellows. I know a lot of them, and they're all pretty decent fellows when they're sober. And some of them, even when they're nice fellows. Take a certain stage of inebriation in order to get nasty. I don't drink, in spite of all the play-up it gets. I don't think it causes as much human suffering as bad dispositions cause. Every woman that has a husband who comes home drunk, there are 150 or 200 women who have to get up sober. And a sober husband, over his great food in the morning, will run more suffering than if once in a while he came home drunk. Now, you may not agree with me on that, and if you don't, certainly it isn't serious. But that's my opinion. Because I've never up to now suffered from anybody. But oh, brother, how I've been lacerated by church people, by difficult people. I say because it tortures the heart and not the body. In the old times, maybe they do it still in England. They're executing a man, hanging him for the rule. The executioner would come up to the old boy, ask forgiveness, and say, I am deeply sorry for what the law requires. And he would put the sting all out of that which he was about to do. So that it was hardly where a man went mad to the gallows, or cursing his execution. He might have cursed the king, or the court, cursed his execution. Because the executioner took the bitterness out of it by a humble, honest apology for having to do what he was about to do. So that the kind words from the man who's about to take your head off will take a lot of sting out of the power. But when the executioner works on your heart and your nerves and your mind and works continually every day and next week and next month and next year and year after that and never stops, and never quite in the next, but always lacerated and hurt and stink. And you know when you walk into her presence or his presence, it's like biting bitter wind. Stinging, chapping, and chafing. And I say there's more torture there with the heart and the nerves and not with the body. And it's always present. A bullet sometimes is very more merciful. Many a man has killed his wife. He wouldn't have been found shooting her, but he killed her nevertheless, and many a little old dried-up apology for a human being, unable to call his own name, unable to breathe it up. And his wife, if she had been merciful, she'd have murdered him and had it over with. But she's murdered him every life in blood died. And the result is that a bad disposition has caused more pain in that than a bullet would have caused, or any other great dramatic act of sin. A bad disposition, alienated mind, broken home, and destroyed confidence in really perfectly sure of one thing. There is a mentor within the human breast that is too wide at Adamic state. There is a mentor, a teacher within that tells him that true religion is kind and loving. Therefore, a bad disposition, you will never be able to make your testimony sick. For nobody will believe you're a Christian. You even ask a Christian if he has a bad disposition. A man is silly, difficult, bad humor. Arbitrary, unreasonable, overbearing, unfair, any one of these will only out completely. And I think personally that's why the main churches never get anywhere. They grind, wheels turn, nobody gets anywhere because there are so many people, even in places of leadership, that are not caught, but have surely gravelly dispositions.
It gives them away. Nobody believes in a Christian like that, and I don't blame them about it. In fact, I don't think the devil bothers a man like that very much. He's doing too good a job on his own. He doesn't need any satanic help. Destroying his testimony more effectually than if two devils perch one on each shoulder. Now, you will flee from this pain if we can. I imagine clubs were invented for that, though I would call, but I just think that might be. But I know that you get away from these if you can. Some of you smile a kind of a tender smile and say to yourself, oh boy, when the whistle blows, am I glad to get out on the street. And I'm glad to get out of that office, out of an icy wind. Walking out where there are friendly policemen and people who want to push you over. But the fellow in the office means it. He's got a surly disposition in here. Lacerate. So I say mostly we see away from it if we can, but you know sometimes we just can't. We have to live with it. And living with it all the time, even in your work, recurring constantly day after day, in your home, or in the apprentice state, for Christ's sake, you must. Brother, the big job then is to learn how to live with the power color. Very man, the digital color. Now, I'll briefly outline here for you, as I told you. Explain how we're to do it. May God help me to teach you to learn quickly, and you, the listener, also learn. Verse 19, that there is eternal value in this kind of suffering if you are. Bible says, if you are not innocent, then all of that punishment you get, just you just get, and you'll never get any other reward for it. So he says, now if you're acting like a Christian, and you're not to blame, and still these bad-humored, difficult, surly people insist upon making your life a hell, are you taking eternal value in it? You're doing something worthwhile, says the fellow. It's thankworthy, it says. Now, verse 20 says, that there's no value at all in it if we're to blame for it. As draws the fire of his employer, or his husband, or the wife, or the body, they draw their fire and abuse, but they're to blame for it, and they're only getting what's coming to them. Peter says that won't all in the day of Christ, because God scales are always balanced, and if I act mean and get treated meanly, why, it is an eye for an eye, and a foot for a foot, and a hand for a hand, and a tooth for a tooth, and I won't be getting what I deserve. But if I decently and get abused in return, then I have an overplus of profit there, and that profit is merit in the days to come, not men but merit for my crown, if any. Then he said, verses 21 to 23, that's way, but I think I ought to add this word here. But Peter seems to indicate here that if you are living people and they're making your life hard to live, and you're grumbling about it, you're not going to get any reward either. A grumbling saint is a crownless saint. You're going to have to be uncomplaining. Husband treats me terribly, abuses me. Sometimes I lose my temper and tell him off. This is the moment you lose your temper, your golden crown goes down the drain. It's melted up and gone. Because God never rewards anybody anything that they grumble when they do. I have sometimes done things that I didn't want to do and knew that I wasn't doing it. I was under pressure. I didn't want to do it. And I pitied myself and felt I was being mistreated, but I went and did it. There's no reward for that. I have too much realism in me to expect the Lord to coddle me. God isn't coddling spoiled things. So that if you grumble about it, you lose it. Then, verses 21 and 23, Prophet Christ went his very way. So the rule is, if you are doing right and suffering for it, then your life will. And the rule is, never follow any footprint unless there's blood in them. Because there are been leading in all directions from where you are, and you can take any one of them you want to.
always look for God's blood and footprints, and then follow them, for they are made by the man of sorrow who is acquainted with grief. Christ went that way, and if you go there, you'll be going the way of Christ. And Christ never fought back, therefore the rule is never. Because if you fight back, you lose all benefit. But the scriptures say, all to God, and he will understand, and he'll reward. Verse 24, suffering can be fruitful, for suffered redemptively. Now you can't suffer redemptively, do you know why? You can't suffer redemption, all redemption has already been suffered. Our Lord on the cross, once for all, suffered redemptively and gave himself a judgment and said, it's finished. And God wrote a period after the book of redemption so that there's no more redeeming to be done. If Christ were redemptive suffering, your suffering cannot be redemptive suffering. They don't need to be, but be profitable to you and to others. You suffer for the Lord Jesus' sake from the devil you may be found, or the forward woman, the difficult man, the hard to please woman, the surly, the bad humor person you're forced to be up against. You can turn that into glory. Three different things. First of all, you can glorify God in it. You can shame the devil. Well, the devil is ashamed when he sees a Christian being abused and he doesn't abuse back again. And he sees it in a surly way and he doesn't reply in a surly fashion. The devil is ashamed and God is glorified. Second thing that this will do for us, if we learn to live with difficult people patiently, is to purify us. We all need to be purified. And suffering is one of God's cases. And suffering is never pleasant. They say that it's never been discovered a convenient place to have a, no matter where you have the thing, it's always in the wrong place. And there never has been discovered any suffering yet that was pleasant. If it was pleasant, it wouldn't be suffering. It's harsh and grinding and ugly and hand papers the teeth, and yet it's purifying thing. Therefore, you see how we treat the devil, how we spoil him and rob him. The devil can ruin with some difficult, horrible person, and commits there your life where you can't get away. And God says, "Now I'm not going to change that any. I'm going to leave the devil's pattern same." And then I know that third person to become a buffer, to buff my child and make him shine. I'm going to let the forward, surly companion become a bitter medicine to heal my beloved. So my good surly friend, it could be that you're your wife's sanctification. It could be, sister, that ugly disposition of yours is making that a crown on your husband's head to shine. It could be that ugly, surly boss you work for is God Almighty's agent sent used by the Lord to polish you and teach you to keep your mouth shut and obey so you'll know what to do when you get married later on. Now the matter of purifying everybody, purifying people. I hesitated to speak along with difficult people because I was afraid that the tail would wag the dog. And I was afraid that I'd throw the boomerang on them. And I have no doubt that some of you smiling people, smiling inside, are saying, "Oh boy, how you need that." Brother McAfee to feel self-conscious because I didn't mean him. The fact is, he's no good to me at all when I mean him, because he's too easy to live with. We've been together so long and never had one bit of trouble yet. If I ever got their attention to it, so the result is, we never had even a hot word, never in 10 years. So he's no good to me that way, you see. Are those that I have had, they really are good to me. They help to polish me.
I just see two superintendents over here, and somebody would say, I suppose that mechanism put up against the district office. In all the years our brother's been here, we've never had to have, never anything. He's asked me to be here, done it. And he's no good to me either. So that my two close brethren here, one who's associated with me daily, here officer, they're no good to me because they don't purify me. But in the long run, the Lord tells people along, shall I share with you a letter I got last week? Well, a lady wrote me from the beautiful thunder, the voices are soft and drawly. And she said, dear Mr. Childers, I heard you out last summer. And I came up to you after your first sermon and said, I drove so many, I think, 100 and preached tonight. And you said, I hope you were not disappointed. And I, with my smooth southern talk, said, no, I was no, I lied. And she said, I've had that on my conscience ever since, and I'm writing this letter to ask you to forgive me for lying to you. I've been getting such nice letters from people now that I'm giving up the weekly. They're writing me such nice letters that I guess don't need to go lady along in order to sort of use it as an abrasive, polish me off a little. Now that's only a bit of, you know, and humorous, and I admire the woman. I admire that. That was honesty itself. But she's way down there, and I never saw her. I don't have to live with her, but I have to live sometimes as a minister. Move in and out, and you have to as a layman, you as an employer, you as an employee, you as a salesman. You have to let our verses expand papers and policies. So don't run away any more than you have to, and above all, complain. As soon as you complain, you take these braces power off. Like some of you need to oil those brake bands. As soon as you oil the brake bands, you're not brakes anymore. And as soon as you don't the friction, you haven't friction anymore. So God, if you don't oil you up there, you're going to let that work on you. Polishing you and polishing your crown. Third, this suffering can be fruitful in that it brings men to God. You can't suffer with them, but you can suffer to win men to the Lord. I saw yesterday a dear little lady, good behavior and expression. The earth's begun to pull her down now, pull her down. Down, she's little and dry and bent. And I remember when her husband used to come home drunk. From chin down. And that little woman, complaining, only praying for him, would pull those dirty, filthy clothes off of him, scrub him up, and put him to bed. Years and years. And finally saw him gloriously converted to Jesus Christ. And he went on his back, and I had his funeral. Happy as God, he went off to be with his Savior. But it took a woman who was so and so spiritual that she could perform that offensive task over and over again, namely. Now, if she had done it and then skinned him alive as soon as he came out of his drunken, he never would have been converted. He never would have believed in it. She kept her little mouth shut. She prayed and she prayed with the life, and the result was that great big German man just couldn't take that kind of spirituality, so he put the written day practice. For if you live for Christ as the truth, and learn to live with Jesus Christ, people understand, you can keep things about and don't complain, the result will be that we'll leave a flavor and fragrance behind them of the Savior. He suffered for us, and to whom we have now returned, the shepherd and bishop of our souls.